Good morning. My name is Gawain. We're going to be talking about transparency in the age of privacy and trust. So in 2013, I was working at Nestle, in a group marketing function, possibly just like yourselves, perceived as a digital expert in the business, working with brand marketeers, working with traditional marketeers on above-the-line campaigns. At that point, Nestle was only spending about 10% of their total media in digital. However, they understood that the consumer was engaging more and more online, as Nick just showed. In 2013, my boss's boss called me into his room. I was new in my position. I hadn't actually met John before, and John called me in. I was a little bit apprehensive and a little bit nervous. I'd been helping brand marketeers on analytics, paid search, and social media. And John said to me, "Gawain, can you take me through what programmatic is?" And it was that pin drop moment, the mic drop in the room, when I had to be honest to John and said, "Honestly, I have no idea. Why are you asking?" And he said, "I've just met with my agency, and for the last 20 minutes, they've used the term programmatic about 64 times and telling me to spend more money in it. But actually controlling the UK's marketing budget, I have no idea what that is." And possibly some of you here today are also discovering what programmatic is. And at that point, I had to leave the room and quickly do some research and discover what programmatic was so I could go back and have a conversation with John the next day. And yes, I did learn. As Chanel said, I was also a client of Jellyfish at Nestle. We brought them on board for analytics and then to actually run programmatic campaigns. And I just wanted to be clear and transparent on that because I was also a client and many of the people who worked on my campaigns I now work with on a day-to-day basis. Now, being a fan of Nestle myself, I thought it would only be appropriate to actually show one of my favorite TV commercials in the last couple of years.
It's very robust, it's very full-bodied.
Really, George?
Really,
George?
¿En serio, Jorge?
You know everything that goes into a cup of Nespresso.
Really, George?
Nespresso, what else?
Nespresso will use the term from bean to cup. As we just heard in that advert, we know everything that goes into that cup. How many of you can honestly say, in any of your digital marketing you're doing today, how many of you categorically know where your ads are appearing or how much money you spent yesterday? Let's be honest, most of us, it would take time to find out that information, even if we could. And I see some smiles in the room because we may as well be honest with each other. That is reality. It's reality. However, what I take from this advert was actually the team I sat next to at Nestle was the supply chain management team. How many of us in this room as marketeers have actually spoken to our supply chain teams? It's the raw materials or the commodities that your businesses hold that actually make your businesses as successful as they are. It's not your paid media. And I say that because when we look at supply chain management, it's a highly detailed system used by small and large organizations to get product to consumers, obtaining the raw material, manufacturing and delivering the final product to the customer. A well-organized supply chain management system involves optimizing operations functionality to be fast and efficient. If we think about that TV advert and actually bring it back to our day-to-day jobs, George's role there was very much guiding and navigating. Nespresso knows the individual farmer, how much that farmer or the publisher was paid for that advert. They know what field and what day and what time that particular bean was either grown or picked. They understand how that has left the field in Colombia and ended up here in the local grocery store. And I say that is because the supply chain management teams in your organizations take control. They understand the processes, and those efficiencies is what drives the businesses forward. And I say that because when John called me into the room, I didn't understand what programmatic was, but I learned very, very quickly. I understood if I didn't take control of the media supply chain. And again, another question I asked my agency, could you tell me every single dollar I've spent in the last year on what websites? Honestly, it took them 5 weeks to tell me. And then I started to look where all of my money had been spent. And I'm thinking, Nestle is targeting housewife and children, but we're spending an awful lot on sports sites. Housewife and children and sports, I kind of possibly don't get that. So I started to dissect the media where we were appearing. Now, as I said, it's the materials, the components, the manufacturer, the retailer, the customer. When you go back to your businesses, if you haven't met with your supply chain teams before, go and have a conversation with them. Understand how they procure your materials, how they actually work, and think, can I actually bring that forensic way of working into my day-to-day job in paid media? Because as I said, and we've looked at this, there is a lot of people out there who want to take part of your dollar. For me, I want to give as much of my money to the publisher as possible. However, 60% of that spend, typically, if you're not controlling your ecosystem, ends up in non-working media, and it becomes harder to grow your market share. It's about having the transparency. So what I built at Nestle was a business plan, programmatic maturity. I've been honest with you so far. When I started at Nestle, I didn't know what programmatic was. We need to be honest with ourselves. Most businesses, and Google will talk about this as well, are going through digital transformation. Change is happening, but that is led by us as the consumer. My daughter's 18 months. I'm embarrassed to say, but she's got an iPad addiction. Waffle the Wonder Dog plays in our house 24/7 on the iPad, on YouTube. We're smiling, but some of your brands advertise to my daughter every single day. She does make purchasing decisions, but she can't talk yet. But you haven't actually turned off that functionality within YouTube on children's Waffle the Wonder Dog adverts. And I say that because, again, it comes back to responsibility. You're controlling your business. So this is a term that Google, and I'm sure many of you have seen, nascent to emerging to connected to multi-moment. I'm going to pause for a second, and I just want you to have a little look and just think, be honest with yourselves. Where are we as a business today on this journey? Are we nascent? Are we emerging? Because every single brand I now engage with, it's the very, very first thing I bring up. Because what I like to do is actually build a maturity plan that is relevant to yourselves. Now, here's the results. There are only 2% of brands globally that are actually at multi-moment. When I talk to Google and you know, our expertise is only 8% of brands are nascent. No. 70% of brands are between nascent and emerging. The world's biggest brands that you may look at and think are very sophisticated in digital marketing, honestly, no. Because we're all going on this journey together, we're all discovering, we're all understanding what's happening. So when we actually look at this research that was conducted, is the vast majority of brands are still at the start of digital maturity. However, like I said, this is a maturity framework that we at Jellyfish have built for a CPG brand. They are not they're not a direct response brand, so it's relevant to themselves. Client owns the technology. I hate to say it, if you don't own the technology today, it's not your data. Google can't talk to you. If you don't own the technology, you're giving your money to a third party who can do whatever they want with it. And that's your consumer data. You're giving your customer data to third parties on a daily basis. KitKat does not give out the recipe to anyone. But how many of your brands are giving your customer data away? We then have clearly defined operating model. And what I did when I was at Nestle is I started to build my knowledge. I had more and more brands, WFA, World Federation of Advertisers. The world's biggest brands were starting to approach Nestle and asking what we were doing. So we put five golden rules together, which we'll go through today. Clearly defined operating model. It's down to yourselves to control your destiny. Consolidated media buying. No longer 46 different websites. The publishers you've heard of. You control your own destiny. Often, when I talk to brand marketeers today, gentlemen in the front, what websites would you like to be on? Which brands, you know, for your brand, which websites would you like to be on? Just websites that, you know, you believe your target audience would be on. Perfect. So often when I say that to a brand marketeer, and then we actually look at where the inventory's going, is a complete disconnect. Because the marketeer is not actually taking control of where their media spend is appearing. And then multi-moment was an audience-based buy. So when we actually look at this maturity framework, it's actually built specific to the individual brand. So they are, as I said, a CPG on mass awareness. However, the framework is built relevant to themselves. So programmatic key considerations. And these slides are all available, so there's no need to take pictures. We're going to send these out afterwards. And very much take these back to your business and kind of evaluate where you are on that maturity framework and kind of take these golden rules as a starting point wherever you are on your programmatic evolution. So what is your operating model? Understand ad tech in programmatic. Brand safety, ad fraud, and viewability. That is your responsibility. Publishers are key. And data and measurement. So what is your operating model? Now, we hear lots of talk around in-housing. In-housing is a very popular topic at the moment where brands are actually taking control of their end-to-end marketing. Now, when we actually look at this, yes, it's happening. But define what an in-house solution is. At Nestle, when we had the understanding and the knowledge, we weren't running it ourselves. But it was considered in-house because we had the internal expertise. Brands are very much upskilling on their knowledge with various degrees of in-housing, from owning the technology to a hybrid solution where they're working with agencies, and very rarely brands then doing everything themselves, as we see here. So nascent, at a minimum, the direct tech contracts. If you don't own your tech contracts, that's the most important thing you will ever do, so you actually control your own data. Emerging, naming conventions. Brand defines the brand safety, viewability, upskilling internally in your organization. My biggest job when I was at Nestle was knocking on doors of brand managers and educating them what digital was. I was there talking about digital 24/7 and understanding how I could help them best. In-house capability to connect it at a maximum direct contracts and ownership of execution. The vast majority of brands today are still very much at the nascent to emerging. And many brands actually stop at that point by just owning the ad tech and understanding where your inventory is going. We saw a significant improvement on our working media ratios. Our viewability went up, our brand safety increased, and we actually appeared on the websites that our brand marketeers wanted to be on. So what are the reasons to potentially in-house? A greater fee transparency. How many are working with partners where they say, okay, staff, resource cost, technology, 30%, but there's no breakdown? By owning the technology, you will actually understand what the real technology costs are. Operational transparency. So often when I start to consult with brands, when we finally get access to the ad tech, we then look at the change history logs, minimal optimization in the campaigns, although a fee is being paid. Incentive to perform and supply chain management. Strategic, the control of the technology, you can see this yourself, a control of data and usage, owning your own data, and from an operational perspective, the direct contract with vendors, because the decisions are owned by you. You are making the decision. Am I going to use Google's native product or am I going to use another native product in the market such as Teads or Unruly? You're making that decision yourself because you're taking that supply chain management method. However, in-housing isn't for everyone, and there are some, you know, potentially higher technology costs, fixed costs challenging for a seasonal business. If anyone here is running a seasonal business and looking for a head of programmatic and you only have two campaigns per year, please come and talk to me afterwards, because I can play golf for the other 10 months of the year because you don't actually have a need for me. How do we actually increase our headcount during busier times? It can be a challenge. Strategic, it's harder to innovate. As we saw, the likes of Uber, who's a technology-first company, work with Jellyfish on innovation. Unable to buy all the inventory. Yes, that's true at the moment. However, as Nick showed, more and more media out of home, television will be traded in a programmatic manner over the coming years. And from an operational lack of infrastructure, it's actually really hard to recruit good talent, regardless. I've been working with a bank recently. We, as digital marketeers, I look around the room, kind of smart casual. The bank wanted the programmatic traders to wear suits with a tie. A programmatic trader wearing a suit and a tie, surprisingly, they didn't actually get any applications. But it's hard to recruit and retain talent. Understanding the ad tech in programmatic. As we saw, there's numerous different demand-side platforms, different ad servers. At least have an understanding. Even if you take the technology ecosystem, put it on a dartboard and throw a dart at it, whichever one that lands on, work with that technology vendor, but actually make a decision. Understand who are the key technology providers and look at the pros and cons of each of them and start to understand how that technology integrates and works together. Not all technology connects and works together. So, brand safety, ad fraud, and viewability. How many of us who are running programmatic campaigns through agency partners actually have a list of every single website you might appear on? A whitelist. Lots of us don't. When I was at Nestle, when I asked my agency for that whitelist, they gave me 36,582 different websites. I then asked the agency to actually go through and check each one of those sites individually. Because it's a responsibility of us with our marketing dollars to actually understand where our inventory is going to appear. For me, a brand safe site may be different to another organization. So actually own that list yourself. Work with your agency partners. Viewability. I thank each and every one of the brands who were my competitors when I worked at Nestle and then at Diageo, because they never asked for a viewability guarantee. If you don't tell the publisher what percentage of the inventory you want to be seen, they're not going to give you the best inventory. They gave it to me because I had my own standards. So you as a business, if viewability is important, what is that viewability target? 50, 60, 70, 75, 80%. But if you don't tell the publishers or the technology what your targets are, they're not going to give you the very best inventory. They're going to carry on giving you the inventory and charge you the same price for inventory that's just never seen. But I always thank my competitors for that because they didn't have that strategy in place. Ad fraud. Robots don't buy Kit Kats. As simple as. Again, we do need to use software to actually monitor ad fraud. Robots, crawling websites, ads load, you're paying for them. So again, work with your legal teams and work with your internal teams to come up with your own policies around viewability, brand safety, and ad fraud. Creating a digital accountability plan for your business. Reputation management, as I said, it's very much a shared responsibility with you and your agency partners around your digital accountability plan. Do you have access control of the whitelist and negative keywords? If you don't have that, that's an email you need to send to your partners later on today. Can I understand the whitelist? Review it. If viewability is a consideration, come up with that number and communicate that to your partners. And are you understanding and influencing the ad tech decisions? Because if you don't, you're going to be using technology that may well not be appropriate to your business. And if something does go wrong, if a banner advert or a display advert does appear against inappropriate content, A, how long would it take you to find out who that vendor was? But what internal measures do you have to communicate that back through your organization and potentially to the press as well, who may well have picked up on that? Because your supply chain management team, if there's a product recall, they will understand the exact batch number, which grocery store has that particular batch and in which particular individual stores within that grocery group. They understand how to do a product recall very, very quickly. But would you honestly, hand on heart today, if an advert appeared in an unsavory place for your brand, would you be able to identify how that advert was placed? But more importantly, then have a communication plan in place to actually explain why that happened. Digital media now is no longer test and learn budgets. We're spending significant money in digital media. Publishers are key. How often as brands do we meet with the publishers in this market? Probably not enough. But the publishers are the individuals who control your destiny. And I say that because the publishers know what the best placements are on their websites for viewability or click-through rates or engagement levels. If you're not talking to the farmers in the field, if you're not talking to the publishers, then again, who are the 3 to 4 key publishers that you want to build a relationship with? You must talk to those individuals. When I work with brands, I have 65 questions I send publishers. So as we build out trusted marketplaces for the brands I work with and consult for, we have 65 questions that go to publishers. One of those questions is, can you please tell me your 5 best placements for viewability and or click-through rate? And if my client is optimizing towards viewability, guess what placements I buy? The 5 that they've told me has got the best viewability. As I said, how often? Not enough. Speak to the publishers. And I say that because we as consumers, and just look at these stats, we're online. If we're online 24/7, our consumers are online. We need to be talking to the biggest publishers out there to really start to control our destiny. As I said, ensure the publisher is aware of your target audiences, understand how the publisher monitors brand safety, how does the publisher yield optimize its inventory, what audience data does the publisher have and how can you use it? Nick spoke about floodlights. Ask the publisher if you can put a floodlight on their website. You may well be surprised. At Nestle, our hardest audience to attract was cat owners. Because a cat owner doesn't have a particular DNA sign that says, I'm a cat owner. However, by working with a news publisher with a classified ad system, we were able then to target via our floodlight people who are in market for kittens. When we knew they were in market for a kitten, because they were looking at classified adverts to buy a cat, we were able to bucket that audience and then serve them relevant advertising for Purina's kitten cat food. Think about how you can work with publishers. How can you put tags on their website with their permission to collect audience signals? And finally, data and measurement. And bring this back into your digital maturity plan. Very few brands are going to have an attribution model immediately. It may well take time to build and redefine. Potentially for brands such as Nestle, where it is, or Diageo, which is high impact, reach and frequency, it's all about viewability, brand safety, and appearing on the websites that matter. So how are you going to individually measure yourself? And start to think about the campaign planning and execution. How integrated is programmatic into your wider media buying? Is it still a silo, or is it integrated into the wider media laydown? How apparent is this within or outside your organization? Is everyone aware how you'll measure success? Often, campaign metrics change during campaign. If you're not telling your partners what those keys to success is, it's very hard for them to actually understand what you want to achieve. And does everyone agree to the metrics before the campaign? Because again, we need to set the technology up to actually enable the software to optimize towards your business objectives. And how will conversion audience data be used during the campaign to make optimizations? Frequency of optimizations. Do you ever ask your agency partner how often they optimize? Recently, I've been working for a brand, and I can't say which one it is. They spent $500,000 in YouTube over 1 month. They paid an agency partner about 10%, $50,000. We estimated the work in that campaign took 3.5 hours. 3.5 hours for $50,000. It's good going. However, because that brand now owns the software, they were able to go back to their agency partner who they worked with through the work we were doing, and now they've actually renegotiated their compensation plan for the agency based on time and material rather than on a percentage of media. So by owning the technology, it's enabled them to go in, upskilling their knowledge, understanding what's going on, and remunerating in a fair and compliant manner. And post-campaign, how are the key data insights captured and pushed back into future brand planning? Where are our post-campaign analysis reports? And as we go into our next campaign, are we using those reports to really refine and define who our real audience is by using audience data, rather than the perceived notion of who we think our target audience is? Again, with your first-party data, you can very easily push that out to publishers through Google in an anonymized fashion and ask those publishers what the match rates are. You can then see where the overlaps are and start to understand which of those publishers your conversion audience is actually reading or engaging with on a daily and weekly basis. So in conclusion, digital maturity is unique to yourself. The digital maturity roadmap is unique to your business. Be clear and concise on your operating model. Understand, control your own destiny, the supply chain management process. Publishers are key to success. Nespresso speaks to the farmer. They compensate the farmer and they educate the farmer on what their business objectives are. Publishers control your destiny. And treat them like your coffee beans. Treat them like the raw materials or the commodities in your business. Because if you treat them with that level of respect, you'll see untold benefits back into your business. Because what you want to do is engage with consumers, customers. And that is the websites those individuals are going on.